Good morning, everyone. I'm so sorry to break into your conversation. Good morning. My name is Jenny, and I'm a member here of the church family here at Kirkpatrick. It's my privilege to welcome you this morning to God's house, whether you've been coming along here every Sunday for decades, or whether this is your very first visit, whether you've come from just down the road, or whether you've come from across the ocean, wherever you call home, you are welcome here today in God's house. Isn't it amazing to think that none of us are here by accident this morning? God has designed and purposed for each of us to be here. He is delighted to meet with us here, and he has things to bless us with and challenge us with in our time together this morning. So let's prepare our hearts to worship and hear from the Lord with these words from Psalm 107. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story, those he redeemed from the hand of the foe, those he gathered from the lands, from east and west, from north and south. He led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle, for he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. He sent out his word and healed them. He rescued them from the grave. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. Let them sacrifice thank offerings and tell of his works with songs of joy. So we will sing together this morning, The Church as One Foundation.
Thank you.
let's take a moment now and bow our heads in prayer. Father God, we are so thankful this morning for your Son, Jesus, the Church's one foundation throughout history and our one foundation today and forever. Thank you for your perfect faithfulness to us, your people, both corporately and individually. God, it is only your love for us, your provision and your protection that keeps us, sustains us, and gives us grace and hope to do your kingdom work here on earth. In spite of your perfect care for us, we so often falter, stumble, and veer off course. Forgive us when we go our own way, when we fail to acknowledge you, when we love ourselves more than we love our neighbor and you, when we let differences divide us and drive us away from you and from each other. Lord, turn our eyes back toward you. Forgive us and restore us to fellowship with you and with each other when we wander. Draw us all back to yourself with your unfailing love and tender mercy. Thank you for grace that is greater than our sin and for showering that grace upon us day after day. It's in the precious name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. This morning for our Connecting Church slot, we're very pleased to have Mark Drennan with us, who's a part of our church family here, and Mark's going to talk to us about his work with Children of the Nations. Mark?
Good morning, everyone. My name is Mark Drennan, and my wife Joanna and I have been coming to Kirkpatrick for about 3.5 years now. Although a lot of that time coming to Kirkpatrick was very much like us sitting on our sofa and watching television.
Oh, wow, hello. Thank you very much, whoever shouted, heckled from the back. I'll start again, shall I? So I'm saying good morning. You expected me to say, you could lip read that. Good morning, everybody, and it's very nice to be with you today, and I'm very thankful you can hear me. My wife, Joanna, and I have been coming to Kirkpatrick for about 3.5 years, although, as all of you know, coming to Kirkpatrick during that time has looked an awful like sitting on your sofa and watching television. In the same period of time, my wife and I have had our son, Angus, and our daughter, Juniper. We actually came to Globe Cafe, I should say, first of all, before coming to Kirkpatrick. So when we moved to East Belfast, this became a very natural place for us to worship. So I believe I have a slide on the screen there. I've been asked to share with you for a few minutes today about the International Children's Ministry that I serve with, Children of the Nations. Launched in 1995 by a couple from the USA, and a couple from Sierra Leone, during the height of the rebel war in that country, all moved by the dreadful plight of children in that place who had lost everything and everyone. Children of the Nations now serves 5,000 orphans and vulnerable children every day in Sierra Leone, Uganda, Malawi, the Dominican Republic, and Haiti. The desire is to provide these children and young people with Christ-centered, holistic care, giving them opportunities in education, ensuring that they have everything that is needed to thrive physically, supporting them to heal from the trauma that they have experienced in their young lives, and ensuring that they're introduced to the hope that only comes from the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Led by our local partners, we work to raise these children and launch them into adulthood, equipped with training and qualifications, with character and confidence, and everything that they need to be able to support themselves and their families and to have a transformative impact on the world around them. So a young man like Antonio in the slide here from the Dominican Republic could be the first young person in his family to complete secondary school and then go on and train and complete medical training and begin to serve his community as a doctor. And then in 2020, be appointed by the President of the Dominican Republic to be the director of one of the country's leading hospitals. That's not a great picture up there, but Antonio is second from the right, and he's standing next to the president of his country. That is why our vision statement is raising children who transform nations. I started as a volunteer in Sierra Leone in 2008, and I now get to serve as the UK and Ireland director, which means a lot of things. But it means that I get to work with an international staff team to support the goals and the visions of our supporting partners, their staff and boards, trying to find the resources that they need, trying to support them, providing them with the maybe the training that might be needed that they have identified, perhaps just ongoing support and encouragement to provide children with excellent care and life-changing opportunities, and to help them as they try to answer really tough questions on a daily basis. So questions like, how can the staff team in Sierra Leone provide the best care possible for a young woman who suffered from Ebola, lost her family to that disease, and is now suffering from hearing impairment, very, very partially sighted, and severe learning difficulties? How might the team in the Dominican Republic operate their clinic and surgical center as best as possible to provide for 12,000 people every year? How might we support our partners in Haiti as they consider moving into the part of their country most recently devastated by their most recent earthquake? As our partners in Uganda receive referrals from their government of children in desperate situations, how can we support them to produce excellent social work and case management? How might our partners in Malawi fund their own programming by selling produce from their working farm? Here in Northern Ireland, we have a local board of 7 people and a staff team of 3. And it's funny that I'm talking to you here this morning because without even realizing it, perhaps, Kirkpatrick already has a part in this story. Because while serving as your assistant minister, Reverend David McCullough actually helped me to launch Children of the Nations UK and Ireland in 2012. He was the first board chair and continues to serve on our board here. So here, our focus is on giving people like you the opportunity of coming alongside our partners and the families and children that they support, asking the question that God asked Moses at the burning bush, when Moses suggested that there was truly nothing he could do about the oppression of the Israelites. What do you have in your hand? We're asking you to consider, what do you have in your hand? And we have the faith that we serve a God who can take whatever that is, whether it's a stick, as it was in the case of Moses, or some time, a skill set, a prayer life, some money, whatever God has put in our hands, we have faith that it can have a transformative impact when we use it to serve the kingdom. And always this is about the children. We believe that Children of the Nations was started because a child or because children prayed to God in their desperation. And part of how God answered that prayer was Children of the Nations and the Sierra Leoneans that came together to start that ministry in their capital city in 1995. And from that time to this, the focus is on strengthening families and providing for children in situations like Gadi found herself in. And we're going to hear from Gadi now.
Hello, my name is Gadi Anita Bangale. I am so grateful to God for the ways He has transformed my life. I am so honored to be able to share my experience with you. I lost both of my parents when I was a child, so my grandmother took me in. She did everything she could to provide for me, but she was also caring for 2 other children. She could not afford school fees, and we struggled to even get 1 meal a day. I remember so many times when I was taken out of class and sent home because I had not paid my school fees. But God provided for me when I needed Him the most. I became part of Children of the Nation and I received food, clothes, shelter, education, and people who took care of me. Because of my sponsors, education became an option again. Because of this support, I have now attained a diploma in Christian ministry, a bachelor's in guidance and counseling, and I am pursuing master's of counseling psychology. But my life could have turned out so differently. There are still so many young women in Sierra Leone who cannot afford education. They struggle with abusive marriages, teen pregnancy, poverty, and disease. I thank God for using so many people to bless my life, and I thank you for your support and the many ways you are continuing to help me and other young girls like me beat the odds and have a hope for our future. God bless you.
In the video, Gadi explains that she's completing a master's in counseling, but because of COVID shutting schools and universities down, that's taken a lot longer than was expected, and the truth is we ran out of money. But there's such a need for mental health professionals in Sierra Leone that the idea of giving up right at the end was unthinkable. At the same time as we were having that conversation with the leadership in Sierra Leone about what could be done about this situation, I received a check from Kirkpatrick for just the amount of money that would see Gadi through the second half of this year and graduate in December. So even if you didn't realize it, you've already been a part of this story and a part of Gadi's story. And there's a job waiting for Gadi back home to provide counseling services for children and young people starting in January. And so I thank God this morning for that. And I thank you this morning for that. And I ask that you please, at any time you would be interested in having a chat with me, I'd love to talk to you, particularly if there's something else that you already have in your hand or your heart that you think could be useful in the care of children and young people like Antonio and Gadi. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mark. That's such important work, and I'd like to just take a moment now and we can pray for you in the work that you're doing with Children of the Nations. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your people around the world. Thank you for Mark and Joanna and their family. Thank you for the work of Children of the Nations. Thank you for lives that have been transformed, like Antonio and Ngadi. Father, we ask that you would bless the people who are doing this work, that you would provide them with the resources that they need to continue to touch lives in your name, to transform lives of poverty and hopelessness into lives of hope and opportunity and service. Father, thank you for your kingdom work here on earth and for those that do it. Lord, we ask that you would move in our hearts. Show us the things that we hold in our hands that could be of use or help or encouragement or benefit to organizations like Children of the Nations, and help us to follow through and act on those things. In your name we pray, amen. Thank you, Mark. We're going to sing the next hymn, There Is None Like You, and as we sing, the children may be dismissed to Sunday Club. Thank you. Thank you. Bible reading this morning comes from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 to 16. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you are called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip his people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people and their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. From him the whole body, joined together and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Monty, we look forward to hearing what the Lord's put on your heart today.
Good morning, everyone. And I am not Graham. Graham is still recovering from COVID, so I didn't expect to be standing here this morning. But it's good to be here and good to just share such an amazing passage of scripture as we go through the book of Ephesians together. I may be quite unique among Presbyterian ministers. I don't play golf. I have colleagues who set their emails on auto reply on a Monday with the message, "I'm sorry, I'm away on a course." And for me, that has never been attractive. I have no desire to participate in what has been called a good walk spoiled. You see, the problem is that I've been told all the theory, how to stand, how to grip, where to look, how to swing, what club to use. It's all been explained to me, but I still either take large chunks out of the surrounding turf or hit the ball in a direction that causes panic on adjacent fairways. I just can't put the theory into practice. I just don't seem to be wired to play golf. And similarly, I've been friends who have been taught music theory, but they've never been able to play an instrument. Or they've gone to art appreciation classes, but they still can't paint. They're just not wired for it. Putting theory into practice is not as easy as it might seem. You need to be wired for it, and you need a lot of practice. Now, in Ephesians chapter 4, at first sight, it looks like Paul is making a complete gear shift from theory to practice. It'd be quite easy to categorize chapters 1 to 3 that we've looked at so far as theoretical theology, abstract ideas about God and the church. And now in chapter 4, for the second half of the book, we get the relevant bit, the application, how to put it into practice. Chapters 1 to 3, theory. Chapters 4 to 6, practice. And on a surface, you can sort of see the relevance and truth of that. But there's a problem. For a start, the book isn't written in two halves. It's not a game of two halves. It's a whole. And everything Paul says in these next chapters that we're going to be looking at in subsequent weeks, everything he says there is based on something that has gone before. And secondly, to see the second half merely as practice, like learning golf or the piano or painting, you could get the impression that just by working harder or trying to do better, you can, by practicing and by your own strength and talents, learn to live a mature Christian life. Problem is that it won't be very long before you realize that no amount of hard work will get you there. No amount of hard work will turn us into the sort of patient, gentle, forgiving, pure life, verse 3, that we see laid out in these chapters. Maybe we come to the conclusion that we're just not wired for Christian living. Now, of course, if we'd been paying attention to the earlier chapters, we would know that actually this is in fact true. The wiring is messed up. We're naturally strangers to God, those who have rebelled against him. So what are we going to do? The problem has likely been emphasized in our minds, if you have an English translation, with those subheadings. Halfway down chapter 4, you might read rules for Christian living or instructions for Christian living. Now, if you want, you have my permission to score that out because the subheadings are not divinely inspired. These later chapters of Ephesians, yes, they are about living the Christian life, but they're a continuation of everything that we've heard in chapters 1 to 3. They're about living the sort of life we've already been introduced to. It's because of chapters 1 to 3 that we discover that although we're not naturally wired to live this sort of life, we still can. We still can. So let me impose a little bit of grammar on you. You probably know that in English, commands are also known as imperatives. Statements of fact are called indicatives. And the Bible will not impose a command on you. It will not give you an imperative without first giving you an indicative, a statement of fact that will help you obey the command. The imperatives always follow the indicatives. So when you're faced in chapter 4 with a bunch of imperatives, be humble, be patient, be gentle, bear with one another, it's because of all the indicatives, all the truths about God that have already been communicated in chapters 1 to 3. So then what is it that we are being urged to do in these chapters? Well, one further thing to remember is that whatever commands are coming up, they are corporate. They're not individual. You're not on your own. This is a letter to a church, and the instructions are for all of us collectively. We're in this together. Graham took great delight in telling me that the title for this sermon was United. And knowing my footballing proclivities, you'll maybe see why he was smiling. But all of that is contained in these verses is based on and it flows from our unity as the church. I just want to highlight three of them. And so maybe to avoid me using the word united too much, I've decided to go for the word together. The first thing that will help us live a Christian life in a healthy way is to remember that we have been called together. We're united in our common calling to be followers of Jesus. It's there in the first verse. Live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Verse 4, you were called to one hope when you were called. There's something supernatural that binds us as the church, that makes us one, something that runs deeper than bloodline or race or socioeconomic status or gender or personality. It's a unity forged by the Holy Spirit himself, verse 3. There's only one Lord, one faith, one baptism. We sang about it in our first hymn. One God and Father of us all. Our unity as a church is as indestructible as the unity of God himself. And that is why disunity, whenever that happens, is such a serious offense to him. That's why the first set of imperatives that we're faced with in chapter 4 are connected with preserving this unity. We make every effort to preserve that unity by being humble and gentle and patient with each other's faults, putting aside our own agenda. It applies to local fellowships. There are so many ways in which the enemy can threaten the unity of a congregation. Pride, ambition, selfishness, gossip, jealousy, false teaching, hypocrisy. The possibilities are truly endless. But while those tactics may wound us, and maybe some of us here bear the battle scars and the wounds of church divisions and splits. And more importantly, while they wound the heart of God himself, we need to remember that they don't destroy the church. The battle has already been won. The war has been won. Chapter 2, the dividing wall of hostility has been removed. So whenever we're faced with division or potential division within a fellowship, we should ask the question, what will keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace? Verse 3. How will my words or actions keep the unity of the church? How, regardless of what I want, can I help demonstrate that the wall has come down? And similarly, it can apply in the wider sense, nationally and internationally. This isn't a plea for some sort of bland one-world church. I don't see that aspiration anywhere in Scripture. But it is a plea for spiritual unity. Denominations are fine. In fact, they're probably necessary to help the church be contextual around the world and to cater for different personalities and styles. But just as I can be united with my colleagues all over Europe in my work and still maintain my nationality, so too we can be united across all denominational boundaries and retain our own individuality and distinctives. It's when we allow difference to become bigotry or sectarianism or racism or prejudice or arrogance or exclusivism that we have redrawn a line that Jesus wiped out on the cross. The war has been won, so let us demonstrate that. It's the Holy Spirit-inspired unity of the church that enables us to stand in solidarity with brothers and sisters we've never met in Ukraine and pray for them and grieve with them, or to stand in solidarity with the children of Sierra Leone. That is what we are called together to be. It's the Holy Spirit-inspired unity of the church that enables my colleagues in Israel to run a student movement of Jews and Arabs united in Christ and to see the work of a called church in that land, as Paul has done recently in his trip to Israel, to see what it looks like to be called together to unity. It's the Holy Spirit-inspired unity of the church that was demonstrated in some churches in the United States, taking part in services of repentance and reconciliation across the racial divide in the aftermath of the George Floyd killing. It's the Holy Spirit-inspired unity of the church that should have been demonstrated far more eloquently on our island over recent years. Remember, this is what we are called to. Together, we have been called to preserve the blood-bought unity of the fellowship and of the church. And then secondly, we are serving together, verses 7 to 13. If verses 1 to 6 were a plea against sectarianism and denominationalism, this is a plea against clericalism. These verses are one of the key passages that remind us that all of us gathered here as members of this fellowship, all of us, are ministers together. For centuries, this was an abandoned truth, as the work of Christian ministry was delegated to a very few who were called to a particular vocation. As the Reformation happened, it was partly rediscovered, but before long, a new clericalism took hold again. There are many reasons for that, but one of them might surprise you. It was possibly due to very bad punctuation. And again, I see my grammatically pedantic wife's ears prick up. In the King James Authorized Version that was used for centuries in the English-speaking churches, Ephesians 4, 11 to 12 read like this. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, comma, for the work of the ministry, comma, for the edifying of the body of Christ. The implication being, who equipped or perfected the saints? It was the pastors and evangelists and teachers. Who did the work of the ministry? It was the pastors and evangelists and teachers. Who edified the body of Christ? It was the pastors and the apostles and teachers. But there is no punctuation in the original Greek. So this is how it should read on the next slide. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Why? For the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. So it is all of us, all believers, all saints who do the work of the ministry for the edifying of the body of Christ, equipped by the pastors, teachers, evangelists, etc. We minister to each other. We edify one another. Remember hearing of one woman complaining that their minister was wanting other people in the church to pray and to lead worship and to visit the sick and to lead Bible studies. And she said rather grumpily, "What does he think we pay him to do?" Which I always felt was a little bit like blaming the conductor for not playing the trombone. The role of the pastors and teachers and others with leadership gifts is to draw out the giftedness of all the ministers in the congregation so that the whole body might be built up. And here in Kirkpatrick, we have a church of several hundred ministers. The argument Paul makes is that because we have a king who descended, verses 8 and 9, that is, who became one of us, and because we have a king who identifies with us, but who was then victorious over death, we now have all of us become beneficiaries of his gifts. Just as the spoils of a defeated nation would be distributed amongst the victorious army, so Christ, when he ascended, distributed the spoils of spiritual war among his people in the form of spiritual gifts. And how appropriate it is that we should be thinking of this on Pentecost Sunday. Today, we remember how one day people from many different places and languages heard the unifying message of the gospel in their own tongue. Today, we remember how one day unschooled, previously cowardly working men stood up in front of their accusers and preached powerfully the message of salvation in Jesus. The Holy Spirit, God Himself, had come down and gifted His people beyond their imagining. The Holy Spirit at Pentecost came down and united His people beyond their imagining. And just as it wounds God to see His people divided, I believe it wounds God also to see His people stifled. To see the ministry of the church limited to a few select professionals. Or to see His people failing to reach their potential because they're not using the gifts He has graciously given them. Holy Spirit endowed gifts often lie unopened in the pew. In chapter 1, we saw Paul reminding us that we've been blessed with every spiritual blessing. In chapter 3, we saw Paul saying that he was called to be a preacher so that through the church the wisdom of God would be made known. Now here we see what some of those blessings are and how the wisdom of God will be made known, namely by you and by me using the gifts that God has given us to equip each other and build each other up so that, verse 13, we might reach an even greater unity in the faith. Which brings me to the third point. We are to grow together. The thing I love about the New Testament is that as you read it, it'll always be taking you on a journey, onwards and upwards. Or as C.S. Lewis famously put it at the end of the Narnia Chronicles, further up and further in. Further towards Christ, further towards glory. Always something more to learn, always something deeper to experience. There's never any sense that you have arrived this side of heaven. Verse 13, that's what the until points to. It's our perfection at the end until we reach that full measure. And nor should there be any sense of contentment with a simplistic faith or an immature Christian life. While the gospel is simple so that even a child can grasp it, it is not simplistic. While it is childlike, it is not childish. And Paul here specifically warns against infantile Christianity. I remember hearing one of my professors quoting a certain brand of American Christianity, and it would be fair to say it applies to various degrees here also, as being stuck in perpetual adolescence. The craving for celebrity, a love for God no deeper than a teenage crush, a fear of commitment, a consumerist attitude to church, an individualism more concerned with my rights than what is fair or spiritually helpful, and I could go on and on. You get the picture. Perpetual spiritual adolescence. Because if we stay at that stage, verse 14, what will inevitably happen? Well, we will be blown about by every wind of doctrine, every new social or theological fad that emerges, and we'll fall prey to the cunning agenda of others, verse 14. We'll be like kids moving from one toy to the next. And before we know it, following Jesus just becomes so last year. Those agendas that seduce us away, they might be conservatively nationalistic or so-called progressively liberal, it doesn't matter. Their influence works the same way. Begins by highlighting an aspect in which the prevailing culture and the Bible are at odds, and then it looks for ways in which we change the Bible to reflect the culture, rather than looking for ways in which we can bring the liberating words of the Bible and affect change in the culture. Part of maturing, part of growing up in the faith, is the ability to develop a Christian mind, to think deeply about issues while recognizing the limitations of our own human knowledge, retaining the humility to know that my opinions and my feelings and my preferences and how I think God should be may not be right. A Christian mind will recognize God's truth, and even when it's challenging to do so, it will speak that truth to one another in love, verse 15. So just as it wounds God to see his church disunited, just as it wounds him to see his people stifled, so too it wounds him to see them remaining as infants, unstable in their life and doctrine. He wants us to grow. And central to that growing is the gentleness and patience and humility of verse 2. Central to that growing is the grace to make the extra effort to preserve the unity of the church at all times. Part of that growing together is not being swayed or blown back and forward, but being able to remain focused on our journey towards Christ as we become mature in him, verse 15. He is the one, verse 16, who holds us together. See the unity? He is the one, verse 16, who allows all the parts to do their work. See the ministry? See how it all fits? Called together, serving together, growing together. These verses in chapter 4 introduce us to the sort of life a Christian is enabled to live because of the Holy Spirit and because all that chapter 1 to 3 have taught us about Christ. There's going to be more chapters to come, but we cannot forget the significance of today. It is because of Pentecost that we are called to live this life. It is because only by the Holy Spirit are we able to live it. The gift of the Holy Spirit is the indicative on which all these imperatives are based. But we still fall short, don't we? Now, don't be too shocked. I'm doing this for a reason. They're not made very flattering, these. This should have been an extra large one. But, now, Man United haven't had a great season, have they? And towards the end of the season, one of their last games, it was recorded that the fans had started to sing. They'd started to sing this to the players. You're not fit to wear the shirt. You're not fit to wear the shirt. It could be sung to us, couldn't it? It could be sung to the church. Maybe we sing it to ourselves. And so often we're not. Instead of unity, there's division. At the local level, there's petty squabbles, the personality clashes, the fighting over minor issues. At the wider level, the sectarianism and the separatism. Instead of serving together, there's a hierarchy within the church. There's a refusal to use the gifts God has given us. Instead of growth, there's instability. There's perpetual adolescence. So often, we're not fit to wear the shirt. Do you remember how Paul starts the chapter? Live a life worthy of the calling you have received. So it's as if Paul is saying, hold on a minute here, whatever you think, you are fit to wear the shirt. He doesn't say worthy of the calling that you strive for, or worthy of the status that you hope that God will one day give you. He says it's the calling that you have, the life to which you have been called. It's who you are. I managed to get this shirt from Ewan. And there's a difference between Ewan wearing it and, say, the Man United players, Harry Maguire or Paul Pogba, wearing it. Ewan may aspire to receive the call to play for Man United, but he hasn't. So people don't sing, you're not fit to wear the shirt, to him. He hasn't been called. But what made the fans so annoyed was that the players on the pitch had received that call and they weren't playing like it. Maybe this morning, if you're like me, you feel that you fall short in so many ways of the type of life that these chapters are laying out for us as the church. But that's okay. And it's okay because, A, we're in this together. We don't do this on our own. We help each other. We're a team. And secondly, because we're growing. None of us have arrived. We'll get stuff wrong. We'll never arrive this side of heaven. So we journey on further up and further in. And it's okay because how you perform on a given day doesn't affect the fact that you have been called by Christ, that we together as a congregation have been called by Christ, and that he has given you his Spirit to strengthen us and equip us. And you see, because of that, in God's eyes, you will always be fit to wear the shirt. Live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be yourself in Christ. In his eyes, you are fit to wear the shirt. So now, go out and play. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your grace and patience with us. And based on your Holy Spirit, help us to be as patient with each other and with ourselves, and to recognize that we have been called to this life, and that we are called to serve together and to grow together. Help us to do that this Pentecost by your Holy Spirit, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing together, Shout to the North and the South. You will have received the church email, and I'm just looking at my text from Graham to see what needs to be highlighted. Of course, just after the service this morning, it's our church picnic. So please do just go straight down to Crawfordsburn, to the Scout Centre there, and that area, and we'll just meet together there with our picnics and hopefully have some good, dry, enjoyable time to hang out together as a church family. So that's immediately after this church service. Also, I will put it into the email this coming week. For those of you who are interested in our work with IFES, we actually have other members of my team at church next Sunday. It is Children's Sunday, so it will be very hectic and active. But if you would like to meet some of the other members of our team, then just look out for the announcement, and there will be a get-together before church just for a cup of tea and coffee at 7 Massey Avenue, and you can get the chance maybe to say hello to some of the other members of our team in IFES Europe. Next Sunday evening is our praise and prayer service. So do again look out for the announcement of that and make an effort to come to that. And this evening there is a Pentecost service in Garnerville run by the Belmont District Council of Churches. I don't know if Ruth Campbell is in the congregation. Is Ruth with us this morning? Well, when you do see Ruth, you go back, you may have heard that she received an honor in the Queen's Honours List, Jubilee Honours List. She received the BEM. So congratulations to Ruth. Very well deserved. We're very proud of her here in Kirkpatrick. And do congratulate her when you see her. I think those are all the announcements I need to highlight at this stage. So let's come to God in prayer. Let us pray. And particularly we do remember our Queen Elizabeth at this special, unprecedented occasion marking 70 years of rule here in the United Kingdom. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, King of Kings, Prince of Peace, the one on whose shoulders rests the government of all the nations, you are our supreme sovereign. But Lord, you have instructed us to pray for those whom you have called to the responsibility of earthly authority. And today we pray for Queen Elizabeth, thanking you for 70 years of faithful and selfless service to this nation. We thank you for the ways that she has been true to her calling and fulfilled her duties, often at the expense of her personal preferences. We thank you for her faith in you and her reliance on you to sustain her and help her. We pray this morning that you would keep her strong physically in her old age, emotionally, as she has had to cope like many other mothers and grandmothers with the heartbreak of family breakups and conflicts, and that you would keep her strong spiritually, that she may continue to look to you day by day. We pray for the United Kingdom, that as a nation we too would turn away from all the other gods that call for our allegiance, and look to you as our only hope of salvation. We pray for our province and those called to the responsibility of government here, that they too would look to the example of Elizabeth and forsake their own agenda and fulfill their duty to govern justly and well. Lord, in spite of our frustrations and the inadequacies of leaders, be they in Stormont, Westminster, Dublin, or Brussels, we pray for them all. We recognize that we are privileged, even in these uncertain times, to live in a part of the world where there is relative peace and stability and wealth. We think this morning of Ukraine and other war-torn parts of the world. Lord, be with your people in those lands who seek to bring hope and peace as conflict rages from day to day with more unnecessary loss of life. Lord Jesus, Prince of Peace, through your people in that land of Ukraine, bring an end to the war and thwart the plans of those set only on destruction. We pray for Israel and for Palestine and give you thanks for the beacons of light in the Christian churches there, bringing together Jew and Arab, Israeli and Palestinian. We pray for institutions such as the Bethlehem Bible College and the Fellowship of Christian Students in Israel. Sustain their leaders through times of weariness And in these days of heightened tension, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Lord Jesus, this morning we pray for ourselves and our congregation. Be with Graham as he continues to recover from illness, and for all those suffering the effects of COVID or long COVID. We pray for those called to lead us in session and committee, and for all of us as we seek to live lives worthy of our calling. Help us to minister to one another, to serve one another as we grow into the likeness of Christ. All of this we pray in the precious name of our Lord Jesus and for his sake. Amen. We close by singing, "There is a higher throne."
God calls each of us to minister this week, we remain united together in our pursuit of Jesus, in the Holy Spirit's work in each of our hearts, in our prayers and encouragement for one another, and in our work to bring God's kingdom to bear in this community. Let's enter the week with these words in our hearts. Finally, brothers, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Amen. Have a wonderful week.